I want to share with you today some perspectives about the last 10 years. It's really been 10 years since the business world took notice that entrepreneurial approaches can be effective in finding sustainable solutions and to social and environmental problems. What have we learned in those 10 years? And where is this idea of doing good while doing well going? In my presentation today, I'd like to share a few reflections that result from a decade of being caught up in the social entrepreneurial whirlwind. I hope to give those of you who will be our leaders in the very near future some thoughts into the opportunities and challenges that lie ahead and how you might contribute with your talents and your experience to making the world a better place. My formal role with social entrepreneurship began for me on July 4th, 2001, the day I wrote the strategy of what would become the Schwab Foundation for Social Entrepreneurship. I say formal because my entire 20-year career up to that point had been working either as an entrepreneur or an intrapreneur. But in 2001, I was the director of health promotion at the World Health Organization in Geneva, desperately trying to change a system mired in useless bureaucracy and petty politics, with two PAs at my beck and call and 120 staff that were my responsibility. I was certainly not improving anyone's health, and I was losing my own sanity in the process. I'll spare you the details of how I met Klaus Schwab, who's the founder of the World Economic Forum, but he was tired of the anti-globalization protests directed at the WEF, the World Bank, the IMF, the WTO, etc. To show the protesters he actually had good intentions, he had decided to set up a foundation, although the purpose was rather sketchy at the time. So the deal that I made with him back then was I would write what I thought such a new entity could do, and if he liked it, I would leave my overpaid, cushy, and mind-numbing position at WHO, and I hope there's nobody from WHO in the audience, to implement the vision for the new foundation. And that was how I ended up spearheading what was one of the most exciting initiatives of my career. Between 2001 and 2008, my colleagues at the foundation and I scoured the world in search of market-oriented approaches that combine innovation, resourcefulness, and opportunity to transform the lives of people and the planet. As part of our in-depth due diligence process, we racked up more air miles than anyone today with an environmental conscience should, and began to shape and grow one of the most amazing communities of transformational change agents that exist today. And this is where the mainstream business world that congregated at Davos began to take notice of these unusual mavericks. We acted very much like a Trojan horse, or perhaps more aptly, a Trojan mouse, bringing entrepreneurs such as Muhammad Yunus, Fazal Abed, Jimmy Wales, Wendy Kopp, Bunker Roy, Michai Vidavadia, Wangari Maathai, to the elite world of global business leaders. And these leaders all of a sudden began to look at market creation in a different way. Amazing as it now sounds, Muhammad Yunus and microfinance were certainly not on the global international business radar screen. I remember describing to a CEO in 2002 a name, a CEO's name who you who are doing your MBAs would recognize immediately, the work of social entrepreneurs, exemplified by Yunus and the Grameen Bank then. He looked at me in shock and said, "Those kinds of people really exist?" And then I introduced him to Professor Yunus. That CEO went on to persuade his bank to open a microfinance division. Now, don't let me leave you with the impression that the mushrooming interest in social entrepreneurship was all our doing. Far from it. Ashoka had been around for almost 20 years, but it was quite focused on nonprofit models that were more advocacy than market-oriented, and that has changed. Echoing Green had been around since 1987, but only selected entrepreneurs graduating from U.S. Ivy League schools, and that has also certainly changed. Jed Emerson at REDF out on the U.S. West Coast had been working on the formula for SROI, social return on investment, work that later went into the blended value approach that goes beyond CSR and assesses how companies and foundations can invest in efforts that earn financial and social returns. And in 2002, Jacqueline Novogratz had just left the Rockefeller Foundation with a startup grant for the Acumen Fund, and the Skoll Foundation had just initiated its operations in Palo Alto. On the academic front, the first business school to embrace entrepreneurship, or social enterprise as they then called it, and still do, was Harvard, where Jim Austin, along with Greg Deese, pioneered the social enterprise program. And then soon Stanford, Duke, Columbia, Kellogg, Berkeley also began their programs soon thereafter. European business schools, including INSEAD, Instituto de Empresa, ESADE, St. Gallen, Copenhagen, and ESSEC, initiated their programs somewhat later. Efforts to bring the subject here to IESE were really thanks to the presence of Professor Johanna Mayer. As with most business schools, faculty in general, and certainly in my institution, and where I teach at Columbia Business School, had not readily embraced entrepreneurship in the public interest. It had been due to student pressure and their collaboration with one or two visionary members of faculty in each school that there has been a reluctant acknowledgement that now has just completely turned into a wonderfully supportive ecosystem, that it is a subject worthy of study. At Oxford, it was only thanks to a £4.4 million gift from Jeff Skoll to Said Business School that the Skoll Centre ever came into being. But it was the catalyst that was needed to set off a flurry of activity across the business school and the university. But frankly, we still have a very long way to go. So as we look back, it appears remarkable how in a decade this global movement around social entrepreneurship has mushroomed. But then again, if we consider that it only took 18 days for people in Egypt to topple the 30-year reign of Hosni Mubarak, perhaps social entrepreneurship has been rather slow in comparison. Part of the reason is the confusion that lies around what social entrepreneurship is and what it is not, exacerbated by the fragmentation of the field and the rather elite bubble in which it operates, a bubble I'm afraid the Skolls, Schwabs, and Ashokas of the world have created. So I'd like to start with a description of social entrepreneurship and go on to consider some of the more recent trends that are influencing the direction and the nature of its evolution. And my purpose is to identify those opportunities for those of you who are interested in becoming involved in careers that combine doing good and doing well.